of Care Life Sciences. Welcome on to this webinar on COVID during pregnancy by Dr. Rajashree Katke, Madam. Welcome, Madam.
Thank you.
About InnoCare, we have a presence across all India. We have a wide range of products, right from gynecological care, orthopedic care, and physician care. Also, we have presence in sexual wellness. We as InnoCare, we are focusing on patient care and striving towards helping the nation by offering them the right set of products. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Rajashree Katke, Madam, and I will introduce Madam. Welcome, Madam.
Yes, thank you, Sankalp.
Let me introduce Dr. Rajashree Katke, Madam. About Madam, a brief CV I wish to present. Madam is a professor at HOD at Grand Government Medical College, Mumbai. About academics, Madam is a professor and HOD, medical undergraduate, postgraduate for 24 years. Madam is an ex-committee member of Manodhairya POSCO. Around 150 papers were presented under Madam's guidance. About 85 publications, 171 citations in national and international level. Moreover, there is a contribution by Madam to the chapters in Foxy Focus. About awards and appreciation, many awards Madam has achieved. Awarded from Chief Minister Conducting Camp, Mahila Ratna Award, Best Superintendent Award Associate Appearance, Rajiv Gandhi Excellence Award. About administrative experience, Madam is an ex-superintendent at Kama and Albrecht Hospital, ex-head of the Department Obs and Gyne at Government Medical College. Moreover, Madam is a speaker for various health-related talks on digital media and television. Madam is a member of Task Force on Ayush for COVID-19 and Medical Education and Drug Department, Government of Maharashtra. So many health camps have done in the rural, tribal, and urban places across Maharashtra. Madam, welcome to this webinar. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Yes. Yes. This is a screen sharing.
Yeah, ma'am. You have to click on home.
Yeah.
And click on slideshow.
Slideshow. Yeah, that I'm doing it. But only slides is coming.
Or else you can click on the bottom.
No, I will do a little resume slideshow. 1 minute. Yes.
Yes, yes.
Now it's okay? So let me be, to touch a very important topic of COVID during pregnancy. We are having a global pandemic where the first case of the COVID-19 has been, detected and notified by the WHO December 31st, 2019 from the Wuhan, Hubei. And January 30, 2020, a public health emergency of the international concern was considered. And 11 March 2020, WHO declared COVID as a pandemic. Let's see how it is going. Everybody knows here what is the etiopathogenesis. I'll just go in brief in that. This is a single standard, 80 to 120 nanometer size envelope RNA, and the mean incubation period is around 5 to 7 days. Range is around 2 to 14 days. So let us see how we should go with the pregnancy, because in general, the non-pregnant state, women, children, and the pregnant state, it has a different behavior. So the maternal immune system is the pro-inflammatory in the first trimester for the embryo implantation and the placentation. It becomes anti-inflammatory in the second trimester for optimum fetal growth. And it becomes again pro-inflammatory in the third trimester to prepare for the initiation of the parturition. So let us see how this effect of the COVID-19 on the pregnancy. The pregnant women do not appear more likely to contract the infection because now, but this can change also with mutation of the virus itself, it is giving a little bit a different pathogenesis in a different patients also. However, pregnancy itself alters the body's immune system and response to the viral infections in general. Reported cases of the COVID-19 pneumonia in pregnancy are the milder with the good recovery. This is in general. The asymptomatic pregnancies, this is the curve of showing daily new cases. The CDC now include pregnant women in its increased risk category. Before, in 2019, we are not able to see any of this, how this virus, it was behaving and all those things. But with the pregnant women, there was not much of the risk. Only a few amount of the women, they were going to go into a high risk category. But now the CDC included pregnancy itself is an increased risk category. The higher rates than the non-pregnant ICU admissions. But basically now COVID-19 risk could be studied be higher 70% higher than the pregnant women. So COVID-19 transmission, everybody knows this is for the surface plastic, aerosols, copper, cardboard, stainless steel, and it goes from 2 to 3 days to, every has a different thing on it. Suppose copper has a 4 hours, aerosol has a 3 hours, it's like that. But basically the spread of the disease is mainly through droplets, respiratory infections, and the direct contact as the virus can survive on surface many hours. The vertical transmission, at present there are only a handful of the reports of the vertical transmission, but we are having the cases reported. Like in RCOG 24/7/2020, there were the 6 babies had a positive test for the SARS-CoV-2. So it was first 12 hours after the birth. It was unclear from the report whether the 2 perinatal days were related to the coexisting maternal COVID-19 or not. But basically, we are getting in a world literature, the vertical transmission is there. The emerging evidence probably suggests that vertical transmission is probable. Now it has been even proved also. A review of 71 neonates born to the women with COVID-19 in the third trimester reported that neonatal infection was diagnosed in 4 cases. So this is the world literature, and we are coming because basically nobody has a longer data in a COVID itself in a disease and COVID with pregnancy also. So basically, whatever the world literature is that, I tried to occupy in that. So what are the effect on the fetus? Increased chances of the preterm birth, stillbirth, preeclampsia-like syndrome on oligohedronia. So basically, these are the some observations with the systematic review studies. So a COVID-19 infection is currently not an indication for the medical termination of the pregnancy itself. What are the general guidelines for the obstetric healthcare providers? See, we know everyone that whenever there is a COVID case, notify immediately. Each facility should consider appropriate COVID-19 practices, the behavior. A registry for all women admitted to with confirmed COVID-19 infection in pregnancy should be maintained. And this is very important. Intrapartum services should be provided in a way that is safe with reference. Staff providing the PPE to provide the emergency obstetric, anesthetic, and the neonatal care where indicated. A single asymptomatic birth partner should be permitted. A visitor should be instructed to wear appropriate PPE, or even the mask is very important in that if they doesn't have any PPE. Women should be met at the maternity unit entrance by staff wearing with the appropriate PPE and be provided with the surgical face mask. So let us see what are the do's and don'ts for the obstetric care providers in a COVID-19 pandemic. If a woman meets criteria for COVID-19 testing, she should be tested. If they are having in with the high risk category, then one should also go for that. So elective procedures like induction of labor, routine growth scans, in a first peak wave of the peak of this COVID, we are halted all the elective. Then there was in India, we are having, less amount of the per day cases were there. We started with the elective procedures. And again, with the second wave, we are thinking if it is, there is a more rise in the case, then we have to give a thought about how much we should go for the elective procedures. So specific obstetric management consultation, medical history for all pregnant women, obtain the following information: a detailed travel history, history of exposure to the people with the symptoms of the COVID-19, symptoms of the COVID-19 if the patient has, then coming from the hotspot area or she has any immunocompromise or the medical comorbid conditions. Okay. So this is very important. What the ICMR says, information to be shared with the pregnant woman when it is being needed, you should share the information, because they may not transmit this to the other people. Then this is in general, everybody knows how to do doning and doping. This is just for the this thing to know us how you should go ahead with that, because in the primary level, when the we are new to the COVID, most of the healthcare workers, they became positive because there was a difficulty in donning and doffing, all these things. So that slide has been included. The women should be advised to attend the routine antenatal care around 12, 20, 28 and 36 weeks of the gestation. It depends upon how much area we are having the high rise, higher incidence new cases, and how much is the saturation of the cases is depending upon that, whether you should go more liberal with the antenatal visits or you should restrict it. First trimester, 12 weeks, screen for the medical disorder, investigation, first dose of TT, NT scan, we know all this. 18 to 20 weeks, congenital anomaly scan and all this BP, urine protein and everything. 28 weeks, mental health. This is the more worrying part, because most of the time in a first wave, we are in the lockdown phase. So, you know, worries, care, this has been given a lot of mental issues in the women. Then at 30 to 34 weeks, fetal well-being, growth scan or Doppler, whenever it is indicated, one should go ahead for that. The service providers can assess the feasibility of isolation for the patient at home, especially if in slums or small households, else she could be admitted in a hospital or the quarantine facility. If a woman tests positive, she should be advised to deliver at least at an FRU, or I should say, depending on the conditions, she should go for a better hospital facility. So there are mild infection, moderate, severe, and the critical infection. Everybody knows in that how the, it goes with the fever, sore throat, myalgia. Then there is a breathlessness, then signs of pneumonia and all. We all know about this. How to approach to the antenatal woman? Travel to another country within 40 days or close contact with the confirmed COVID-19, clinical examination, RT-PCR, deep nasopharyngeal or the pharyngeal samples. If COVID negative, stop monitoring. If COVID positive, then you should go into the treatment like a symptomatic COVID positive cases. Okay, then a symptomatic level, how it should be monitoring at the hospital, isolated room with prefer negative. If you have availability, one should go for, otherwise it should have a cross ventilation, light should be there very properly, and isolation at home for 14 days. If they have, generally, we don't advise for the isolation at home for the pregnant woman, but if they want to stay, if they are asymptomatic, then they should be monitored very carefully. If the symptom persists, then hospitalization in a tertiary care center with the maternal surveillance and the fetal surveillance. This is very important. Intensive care unit admissions, which is a quick sequential organ failure. This is a SOFA score in which systolic BP less than 100, respiratory rate more than 22, and Glasgow Coma Scale less than 15. If this criteria is more than one, then you can consider she needs to be directly into the intensive care unit. Severe failure criteria like septic shock, acute organ failure, and fetal distress, it has to be tackled as an emergency. This is about the antenatal. Then how you should go for an intrapartum care. Once settled in an isolation room, the full maternal and fetal assessment should be conducted, including the assessment of the severity of the COVID-19 symptoms. Then delivery should be preferably at a tertiary care center. During the active labor, there are chances of the viral dissemination or a forceful exhalation of an infected woman. See, most of the, we are obstetrician, most of the times what it happens, patient comes with a fully dilated, patient comes with the fetal distress, we rush for the GA, giving general anesthesia and all, and sometimes you get generation of the aerosol, and we can also get infected, so one should get care of that. mode of delivery. There is currently no evidence of favor one mode over the other mode. Means COVID-19 itself is not an indication for cesarean section. Then a role of anesthesia. Early epidural analgesia, it is being preferred. The points of concern is a timing with the VTA and the platelet count. But the combination of the spinal for most cesarean section, it is always being very good because in general anesthesia, intubation of the general anesthesia is an aerosol generating procedure. AGP significantly increases the risk of transmission of the coronavirus to the attending staff. So regional anesthesia, spinal, epidural or CAC is not an aerosol generated. So these are the very important things. We have to be very cautious, you know, and still if you want to give a GA, it is to be planned from the outset. All staff in theater should wear full PPE, including a filtering face piece level 3, FFP3 mask. That has to be very important in that. The scrub team should skip and don't PPE before the GA is commenced. So this is very important. Precautions to be taken during the cesarean delivery. All team obstetrician, anesthetist, pediatrician, OT staff to be in a PPE. Visibility is the challenge. This is the, you know, I was operating a case and I wore that full face shield and the mask. So visibility is really a challenging thing. Then spilling of the blood and the amniotic fluid, it's one of the thing. Then QWERTY use, minimize it because sometimes it can, you know, generate so much of the smoke and all. Delayed cord clamping and skin to skin contact is suspended. Care in the labor, how we should go ahead that. Aim to keep the oxygen more than 94%. So titrating oxygen therapy accordingly, it's very important. Hourly oxygen saturation during the labor. The maternal observation, including temperature, respiratory rate, and on the oxygen saturation. If the woman has signs of sepsis, investigate and treat as per the guidance on the sepsis of the pregnancy, active COVID-19 as a cause of sepsis and investigate according to the guidance. Continuous electronic fetal monitoring in labor is recommended. So this is the same thing in a flow chart. So delivery in COVID positive cases, interdisciplinary team in PPE, then O2 saturation, temperature, pulse, continuous fetal heart rate monitoring surveillance is very important. Mask to the patient is very important and the mode of the delivery to be individualized. Depending upon that, vaginal delivery is always preferred. COVID-19 itself is not an indication for cesarean section. This is one thing. In cases of the deterioration in the woman's symptoms, make an individual assessment regarding the risk and the benefits. So this is all pregnant women with COVID-19 must be assessed for the venous thromboembolism risk score, which if present is an indication for starting the low molecular weight heparin. General advice for the obstetric emergencies in a gynecological theater. We have seen this is just elective procedures, elective surgeries. If it is needed, then one should go ahead with that with the precaution. Then what are the biochemical investigation? One should look for the in CBC, lymphopenia, thrombocytopenia. Neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio has to be more than 3. RBS, LFT, liver renal function test, LDH, D-dimer, APTT, procalcitonin, ESR, CRP levels, interleukin-6, and ferritin more than 500 microgram per liter. Then troponins, NABG. See, this is the all the, you know, scheduled investigations to know how much is the COVID has affected to the systemic things. We are not doing the x-rays in that, but if it is required, the HRCT with the abdominal shielding can be used to protect the fetus as per the normal protocols. This is the CORAD score. Everybody knows in that one is non-infectious, normal. And no abnormalities. Low is abnormalities consisting with the infections. Indeterminate is unclear. And high is abnormalities with COVID-19, which is CORADS 4 and CORADS 5. Very high, typical COVID picture means you will get a consolidation or solid, you know, lungs like that. Then management of patients with the COVID-19 admitted in a critical care, because the medicine people, intensivists, they are managing with the these things. But if the patient is in the labor, then you are also susceptible to do all these things. So women with the severe disease such as tachypnea, more than 30 per minute the respiratory rate, hypoxia less than 90%, less than 80% of the saturation, pneumonia more than 50%, lung involvement. It has to be managed very critically. The titrate the oxygen. This is the very, very important thing. Oxygenation is very important in cases of the COVID cases. It has to be maintained more than 94%. The hourly respiratory rate, looking for the rate and the trend. So a rise in the respiratory rate, even if the saturations are normal, may indicate the deterioration of the respiratory function. Sometimes we see that they say patient, you know, madam, the saturation is 94, 98. It was very good, very good. But patient becomes tachypneic and she deteriorated. That is how the history comes in some of the cases. Then the bacterial infection, you should look for the either increase into the neutrophils. The count, apply caution with the IV fluid management, try boluses in volumes of 250 to 500 ml. This is also very important because you cannot overload fluids in the, you know, when you are resuscitating the patients. If urgent delivery is indicated for the fetal reasons, you can go for that. The mode of the delivery can expedite it. The pregnant woman should be kept in left lateral position with judicious intravenous fluid oxygen therapy when needed, and appropriate antibiotic, antiviral therapy, and the mechanical ventilation as per the patient's requirement. These are the key points when we are managing the COVID thing. So these are the some of the drugs everyone know that we start with: the azithromycin, amoxicillin, cetraxone, to control the infections. Then hydroxychloroquine, of course, was a drug of choice. We have used many in the beginning cases. Then in some of the centers, the study has been developed with the anti-HIV drugs like lopinavir, ritonavir, and that is also explaining the risk we have done in that. Then we will see for the role of the plasmapheresis in the remdesivir. Convalescent plasma therapy neutralizes the virus directly, and it has been approved by the FDA category. So basically, whenever it is in a moderate cases, one should go for the plasmapheresis. Depending, individualization of the cases is very important. Still, we have the drug of choice, which is working, is the remdesivir, which decreases the viral replication in the host cells by blocking the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, but is not approved in the pregnancy. But if it is required for the safety of the mother, then one should go for that. Tocilizumab. Now nobody uses that. In previously also, in some of the cases they have been reported where they have been used in that, but generally we are using now with the, in a critical cases, the remdesivir and the supportive line of treatment. Low molecular platelets, that is also very important in that. The best choice is the dexamethasone 6 milligram daily for 10 days until the discharge if she is in a mild to moderate. Indication, those needing oxygen supplementation and ventilation. So recovery trial criteria is very important in that. If fetal lung maturity, then one should go for a 6 milligram 12 hourly for 4 doses. Sometimes you get the patients with the borderline around 34 to 36 weeks, then we should see for the lung maturity also. The recent guidelines from the Royal College of Obstetrician and Gynecologists suggest the use of intravenous hydrocortisone or oral prednisolone in women who are pregnant or the breastfeeding. So heparin, consider the heparin or the low molecular weight, heparin, in which that enoxaparin, deltaparin, unfractionated heparin. These are the things which is very important in that prophylactically you can give with that the doses are with, you know, deltaparin 5000 international unit, enoxaparin 40 milligram one OD. So prophylactic and therapeutic, it depends upon the cases to cases, it varies in that. Then dose can be decided as per the D-dimer levels, 40 milligram OD if D-dimer less than 500. If it is, 500 to 3000 of the D-dimer levels, then 40 milligram BD. And 1 milligram per kg if more than 3000. Okay. So this is about you. We have seen the antenatal, what is the pathogenesis antenatal, how to go ahead with that, ICMR guidelines, RCOG guidelines, and how to go ahead with the intrapartum care. Now, the most important thing is the postnatal management, where we should be concentrate with the balanced diet. Much more fresh fruits should be there. Then dry fruits if it is required, medications for the pain relief for the COVID, monitoring for the COVID clinical status. Early ambulation is very important in that. Facility should, and breathing exercise, it is also very important. Facility should consider temporarily separating, separate rooms. The most important thing is that mother is a positive and the baby is not positive. at that time, it is very important to keep the baby in a separate room. That is what the ideal thing is that. But sometimes if it is not possible, then it becomes consideration, you know, for the temporary separation, because the risks and benefits of temporary separation of the mother, we have to explain to them and you can keep. But sometimes what happens, co-location, you know, rooming in. So generally in healthy women, you know, non-COVID cases, we keep the baby and we say there will be sharing of the bond and everything, all the advantages of the breastfeeding and mother fetal, you know, friendly approaches, we have been telling all the benefits. But suppose the mother is COVID positive and there is no, I mean, there is no choice of, you know, separating the mother and the baby, then if you want to do the rooming in, then the baby should be more than 6 feet away. You can put a physical barriers on that, plastic sheets or the curtains, and it's like that. And then it has to be monitored in a proper way. If no other healthy adult is in the room to care for the newborn, one mother who has confirmed COVID-19 or is a PUI should put on the face mask and practice the hand hygiene. Means whenever if it is required. Okay. Now comes to the breastfeeding. Okay. During temporary separation, mothers who intend to breastfeed should be encouraged to express their the breast milk to establish and maintain them. Now, I have searched the most of the world literature where we have not found that this has been, you know, secreted in the mother's breast milk. But the thing is that while breastfeeding, the baby remains very close to that. So how to go ahead with that? One is the mask. Second is that hand hygiene is very important in that. But if you have a dedicated breast pump, then with cleaning, we should take the milk out. And then after each pumping session, all parts that come in contact with the breast milk should be thoroughly washed. And the entire pump should be appropriately disinfected as well as the manufacturer's instructions. But this express breast milk should be fed to the newborn baby by a healthy caregiver. Now, if mother is positive, you are taking it out the healthy, breast milk. And if you are giving that to the baby with an infected person, then it is of no use. So what it has to be a healthy caregiver is very, very important in that. Then care of the newborn, deliveries in COVID positive area, neonatologist in PP, we have seen all these things. Then comes to the ACOG, American College of Obstetrician and Gynecology guidelines. Mask or cloth face covering should not be placed on the neonates. And this is very important, younger than 2 years of age. Neto, otherwise, somebody will put the mask on the baby and there will be, problems with the newborn baby. So these are the RCOG guidelines. NICE recommended schedule of the antenatal care should be offered in a full, wherever is possible. We have gone all these three. So I'll skip it. Then vaccination. This is for the influenza vaccination. Women should be advised that vaccination against influenza is safe at all gestation of pregnancy. So they can go for their own influenza vaccines and all. Hospital discharge, ICMR guidelines were there. Whenever you feel that they are negative, then they can go, or completing the, if they are symptomatically better after 7 days, then with observation, you can discharge them. Mental health is a very big problem in that, because isolation, bereavement, financial difficulties, insecurity, inability to access the support systems are all widely recognized risk factors for the mental illness. So some patients, they are feeling sad, hopeless, sometimes negative thoughts, anxiety. All these things, they are coming with the loss of appetite. Patients are coming with us. Nothing is there, madam, bahut ghadbad hota hai, dhadad hota hai. It's like things, and it's quite natural. Even a non-pregnant young people, they are having like this with all these COVID pressure. But we have to take care of this. Counseling is a very important. Role of diet, we have seen. Role of vitamin D, zinc, and vitamin C is very important in that. Supplementation is recommended. All women during pregnancy or the non-pregnant women also, to strengthen the immunity. Why we are able to go with the low course of all these disease, virulences, just because every individual has their own immunity. If their immunity is better, they can fight with the COVID viruses and they will have a mild form of this thing. So generally, low levels of the vitamin D are at increased risk of serious respiratory complications. This is WHO, what they are saying, antenatal and intrapartum, newborn, postnatal, and the mental health. So this is about the WHO organization, which looks for that. I think Ritu has come. A couple of slides are there. I'll just finish it up, okay? This is a very nice study where the, you know, UK has done it, study of 427 pregnant women in May 2020 with the social distancing. The study found that 55% pregnant women admitted in the hospital with coronavirus were this Asian and all. That is a different story in that. Even if a woman has previously tested negative for the COVID-19, she presents with the symptoms again, COVID-19 should be suspected. So we are seeing the reinfection also. So this is very important thing. Then we have 108 number of the ambulance for the transport of the patients. So use of that. Referral to antenatal ultrasound services for fetal growth surveillance is recommended after 14 days following the resolution of the acute illness if it is required. Type of COVID-19 treatment being studied. Single agent treatment, antivirals, cell and gene therapies, immunomodulators, neutralizing antibodies, and the other things. These are the future things. What are the under trial? US FDA has come up with the casirivimab and imidivimab. These are the, you know, some new drugs. They are under trial. Again, it has not come in that, but there is a future. We can look for all these things. Then a solidarity trial of October 2020. In that also, remdesivir, hydroxychloroquine, lopinavir, ritonavir, and interferon. So basically, everything is under the trial, and we have to come up with that one or two of the very good drugs. But till that time, we have to work on all this. But this is one thing which is coming very nicely, is that emergency use is authorized in a US FDA. To the monoclonal antibodies, and these therapy like bamivimab and 700 milligram plus itacivimab also, they are trying with these are the monoclonal antibodies. Somebody is working on the neutralizing antibodies. Part of this, the vaccines, they are under trial. So what is the world literature data says is that there are currently more than 59 COVID-19 vaccine candidates in trials, WHO states. Limited data are currently available from the animal development and the reproductive toxicity studies. No safety concerns were demonstrated in rats that received Moderna COVID-19 vaccine before or during pregnancy. So studies of the Pfizer and BioNTech vaccines are going on. So mRNA vaccines do not contain the live virus that causes the COVID-19, therefore cannot give someone to the COVID-19. Based on how mRNA vaccines work, experts believe they are unlikely to pose a specific risk for people who are pregnant. These are all under trial and assumption. So basically, what are the RCOG guidelines, but what they say. WHO has said all these things. Now let's see what are RCOG, Royal College says. The latest advice from the Joint Committee on Vaccination, because they are working on this, there are some trials, they are going on this women also. The vaccination and the immunization is that COVID-19 vaccine should be considered pregnant to the pregnant women when their risk of exposure to the virus is very, very high. COVID-19 vaccine should only be considered when the potential outweigh of any potential risk of women and her baby. CDC guidelines are the same for the breastfeeding vaccination in pregnancy. What are the benefits for the vaccination? Side effects yet to come in that, but in general, they have a very small injection site pain, headache, muscle pain, fever, chills, like that only. Then does it matter what stage of pregnancy I am? The vaccine should work whatever the stage of the pregnancy you are in. So that JCVI committee of the UK, they are again under the trial for getting the vaccination, either in the first or the second trimester. Let's hope so. We will get a good guidelines in that. This is our experience in the last couple of slides. Grand Government Medical College, where approximately around 300 deliveries, COVID caesarean sections around 145. And we have in a JJ, which is a non-COVID hospital, but still we have been delivered 195 deliveries in that. So age-wise, it is basically more in cases of, 48%. It is going around 21 to 25 years of, and that is the what the age is for the reproductive age group. the urban has affected most of the things in our study, because we stay in the urban in that. Distribution of cases, religion, it's okay, but the symptoms wise, most of them, they were asymptomatic. 9% mild fever, dry cough in 7%, and diarrhea 6%. This is how they have been presented. And most of the thing is that in a second gravida onwards, we are having more cases in our this thing analyzed. And blood group wise, we have got the 28% in a A positive, AB positive 19%. In that, and our high risk cases in that is the preeclampsia, gestational diabetes, APH, PPH, postpartum hemorrhage, twins, prelabral rupture of the membranes, intrauterine fetal demises. So these are the high risk obstetric associations with that. And the comorbidities, because this is the institute and referral centers, so we are getting patients with COVID with hypertensive disorders, diabetes, thyroid disorders. There were 8 patients, diabetes around 2 patients, anemia 12 patients, seropositive with COVID. It's again a very, very dreaded combination. So that is 5 cases, COX around 2, then chronic renal disorders, autoimmune disorders, epilepsy, rheumatoid arthritis. So we are having all the comorbid conditions where we have delivered such patients. So basically, preterm are 19% and 81% they were at the term pregnancies. So we are having a around a good sizable data, and very good work was done by our all the faculties, the resident doctors, healthcare workers and all. So I have presented that. There is no evidence that pregnant women are, what is the take home message? There is no evidence that pregnant women are more likely to get seriously ill from the coronavirus. Okay. So the course depends upon many of the things. The following key precautions are to be taken. Still, we are having rule of 3 things. One is a hand sanitization, 20 seconds, and frequently social distancing of 6 feet. Generally, with a normal, we are saying it is a 3 feet, but with a pregnant woman, go for a 6 feet. And wearing of mask is very, very important, because even after vaccination also, you are supposed to wear a mask. And that is, I think, this is what is going to help. Even with the vaccines, even with the treatment is there, till the pandemic gets settled and we can get a very good answer to it. That so COVID appropriate behavior is must. So please take care of yourself and your patients also. A healthy balanced diet with vitamin D, vitamin C and zinc is advisable, with follow-up as and when required. So references are from WHO, RCOG, CDC, ISMR, NIRRH and all. I would like to say there is always, difficulty is the part of the life, ups and downs, it's part of the life. But what Albert Einstein says, in the middle of the every difficulty, we are still in a difficulty, but there lies an opportunity. I feel we will get an opportunity and some good solution, it will come out of it. And we have fought with this disease very courageously, and all the healthcare workers, they have done a very, very good job across the globe. And some of them, they have lost their lives also. So I think something will be very good, and we are treating the patients, all of them, they have listened carefully. So I'm thank you very much. Thank you, Sankalp, Vaibhav. Thank you, Dr. Ritu, madam. Thank you, everyone. Sorry, I don't know what is the time is there, but if I taken extra some time, I'm really sorry for that.
It's very much. Very nice. Very nice, Dr. Rajashree.
Yes.
Very nice, as usual, very nice.
Welcome. Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you. We will listen.
Thank you so much, Rajashree madam. Thank you so much for such a wonderful knowledgeable session which you have discussed with us. Thank you so much once again from bottom of our heart. Now we have our next.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Now let me introduce our next speaker, who does not need any introduction. Madam Ritu Santwani, madam. Welcome, madam.
Thank you.
She's quite supportive and helpful for us from long. In fact, the webinar series started with madam only. Ritu madam has shown us the platform to InnoCare to start the webinar. So welcome, madam.
From to everyone, not to you, Sankar.
Absolutely right. So over to you, Ritu madam. Just a brief about. Rajashree madam, just introduce our Ritu madam, please, from your end.
अरे राजश्री मैडम मला इंट्रोड्यूस
डॉक्टर रितु मैडम इज अ वेरी बिग पर्सन मैडम इज अ वेरी गुड फ्रेंड
गुड फ्रेंड इज ओके
इनफर्टिलिटी स्पेशलिस्ट a wonderful human being she is a very intelligent and very good doctor good infertility specialist and good orator and she has done a lots of hard work and she has reached to that level ki where a very few people can dream to go there and very few people will get success so she is that role model so I think with Ritu what we can explain she is a self-made person and doing a very good service on a knowledge sharing platform and words are very less to introduce her but she is a very near and dear friend of mine and I wish you a huge success and wonderful life opportunities to you on this platform Dr. Ritu
thank you
me to say few words about her
Thank you, Dr. Rajashree. Thank you so much. For Dr. Rajashree, I can say only one line. A friend in need is a friend indeed. उसके आगे कुछ बोलने की जरूरत ही नहीं है मुझे Our friendship is like that. कि we have done so many shows together and all somehow clicked very nicely. Recently, I have done one series with Nutrify India. So I still remember me and Dr. Katke has done the shoot of that webinar at night 11:30. Again, we want to do some editing we have done in the early morning. So I'm really very, very helpful to, very, very thankful to you, Dr. Rajashree too. And thank you for the kind words. Now coming to InnovaCare, I think it comes like when Sankalp called me, it comes like that I'm coming to my own home. Sankalp, Vaibhav, Harish, they all are so close to me. हमने लड़ाई झगड़े भी किए हैं, लेकिन वेबिनार भी बहुत सक्सेसफुल किए हैं. Let me tell you.
जो बहुत झगड़े करते हैं ना, वही सक्सेसफुल रहते हैं.
Yeah, I am able to see Deepen ji also. So hello to Deepen ji also. I'm seeing his name here. So before I start,
ma'am, I will introduce you few words about you, ma'am. Madam, we invite you once again. It's our pleasure that madam is with us till today, and hopefully will be with us forever, ma'am. Supporting InnovaCare. Definitely, the topic is very interesting. The PCOS and its management. So, doctor, please share your experience with us and a little small introduction. Whatever I can talk about, Dr. Rajashree Madam has already introduced you, ma'am.
Madam,
FIOG, AMRCOG, AIT Singapore. Madam is an IVF specialist director at Pune Test Tube Baby Center and Sham Well Woman Clinic. Liberty Phase 2 in Pune. So welcome, madam, and over to you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sankalp. And before I start, I must thanks to all my friends and who have joined across the globe. I am able to see Dr. Kariman has joined from the Lebanon. Welcome, Dr. Yes. Kariman. Dr. Fatima from Egypt. Welcome, Dr. Fatima. I am able to see Dr. Bina Nayak from Indore. Welcome, Bina madam. So there are so many friends have joined. Dr. Faiza has joined. Yeah, Dr. Faiza. Welcome, warm welcome. Dr. Faiza is I've recently added in my group. So many doctors. Let me first say hello to everyone, then I will start the topic. Yes, Dr. Mrityunjay has joined. Dr. Mrityunjay has also joined from Assam. Am I correct now, Dr. Mrityunjay? Yes, a warm welcome. Dr. Faiza Nazim has also joined. Dr. Fatima Jaffer, we have done so many good webinars I have done with this Arab countries. So Dr. Fatima is my become friend from there. Warm welcome, Dr. Fatima. So many friends are there. Yes,
all of them there.
Yes, so many.
That's so nice of them, and very nice.
Yeah. So, yeah. So I'm start sharing my slides. So friends, meanwhile, before I start, hi Faiza. So I will share my number on the chat box group. Otherwise, those who are here can write also. Just a second, huh? क्योंकि बाद में आधे लोग रहते हैं, आधे लोग चले जाते हैं. So that's sorry. I will speak in English. This is now. So I'm sharing my WhatsApp number here. So all of those who are interested for joining in the academic groups, please WhatsApp me your name and working place, I will add you in the academic groups. Me, Dr. Rajashree, we all are in the academic groups. So I believe on the motto ki knowledge always increases by sharing. So aap mein se jo, whosoever is interested, please inbox me your details. I will add. So now I'm started sharing my screen. Yeah. I hope slides are visible.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Perfect. Yeah. 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 Thank you. Now, why it is not moving? Yes, it's moving. Yeah.
No, it will move.
Yes. With InnovaCare only, I have done this very popular series, The Pundit Show. So, which has given the popularity not only to the InnovaCare, to me also, and to all the faculties also. Still, the people remind me, ki, ma'am, when are you doing such kind of that show again? So, thank you, Sankalp, Vaibhav, in full InnovaCare team. Yeah. So, today, the topic which I'm going to discuss is the PCOS and its treatment. So, friends, as we all know, the PCOS is a very vast subject. So taking all the PCOS aspects is not possible to take in a lecture. So today what I'm going to discuss regarding this medical method, regarding the role of metformin and myonicetol, which to use and when to use and which is better, what are the pros and cons and what the studies say. So friends, as we all know, the PCOS is a very complex condition. What's the prevalence of PCOS in India? Yes, the prevalence has been reported. 30 to 36% girls in India are suffering from PCOS. PCOS is the most common ovulatory disorder, affecting 85% of the women with ovulatory disorder, and in the adolescents also having a menstrual irregularity. The menstrual problems are present in 80% obese PCOS and 30% with lean PCOS, and 20% PCOS having a normal cycles. So these days we are seeing a lot of lean and thin PCOS also. So as we all aware of regarding this pathophysiology of the cyst formation, the pituitary gland releases the excess of luteinizing hormone, which causes the increased production of the male hormones from the ovaries, which causes the failure of bursting of egg follicle from the ovaries, and undischarged egg follicle becomes a cyst. This process gets repeated during the every menstrual cycle. Multiple cysts get collected, resulting in PCOD. So in PCOS, ovulation process is hampered and the ovary shows a small cyst about 2 to 9 mm in diameter. Hence the name is the polycystic ovary has been given. So as we all aware of the symptoms of this PCOS, the irregular cycles, or the scanty menses, excessive facial hair and body hair, hair thinning of the scalp, abnormal skin discoloration, weight gain, depression, stress, and acne. So, as we know, this PCOS, in PCOS is a metabolic syndrome with lot of reproductive implications, which has a huge impact on the reproductive, metabolic, and cardiovascular health of the girls and the women. So it is considered to be as a thief of womanhood. So as we know, the characteristics of this in the PCOS, the insulin resistance, which presents as hyperinsulinemia, gestational diabetes, hyperandrogenism, acne, hirsutism, hormonal imbalance, menstrual dysfunction, metabolic syndrome, the central obesity, hypertriglyceridemia, psychological problems, anxiety, depression, poor self-esteem. So, as we all know, the insulin resistance is a primary root cause in the PCOS. The central player is the insulin resistance. So, as we know, in this, the insulin is a hormone which is produced by the beta cells, the pancreatic islets of the Langerhans, This pancreas contains about 200 units or 8 mg of the insulin, we can see here. And 70 to 80% of the islet is made up of the beta cells, which produces the insulin. So we can see here in how this insulin resistance, the normal insulin metabolism, glucose, insulin, which causes the functional insulin, normal intracellular glucose, while insulin resistance in the bloodstream with the malfunctioning of the insulin receptor site, then which causes the low intracellular glucose. So the glucose metabolism in a normal cell, as we just discussed, the insulin binds to its receptor, forming a complex of insulin receptor substrate, which in turn stimulates the messenger called PI3 kinase, and activated PI3 kinase activates GLUT4, and glucose is then taken by GLUT4 through the glucose channel for utilizing energy, and then IRS complex breaks down, releasing the receptor to go back to its original site. Friends, I know this little bit of theoretical part is little boring, but in the understanding this pathophysiology, these few slides I have added. So PI3K are a family of enzymes involved in the cellular functions such as cell growth, proliferation, differentiation, motility, survival, and intracellular movement. Glucose transporter type 4, also known as GLUT4, is a protein encoded in humans by the GLUT4 gene. GLUT4 is the insulin-regulated glucose transporter found primarily in the adipose tissues and striated muscles. We can see here. So basically, by defect in the signaling of this GLUT4 and the glucose transporters, which causes in turn the diminished glucose uptake. So we can see in the PCOS, due to this, the main causative agent is the insulin resistance, which causes the PCOS or atherosclerosis, visceral obesity, type 2 diabetes, hypertension, and increase in the triglyceride, LDL, and complex dyslipidemia. So the pathophysiology suggests that the insulin resistance is 50 to 80% in the PCOS women, supported by the Journal of the Endocrine Metabolism too. So as we have just mentioned, that is the vicious circle of the insulin and insulin resistance, elevated testosterone, elevated estrogen, increased androstenedione, and increased DHEA. So as we know, this excessive insulin causes the production of the androgen, and high androgen levels lead to acne, excess hair growth, weight gain, and ovulation. So now what's the mechanism that how it causes this overweight? The eating food, carbohydrates, production of the insulin to convert carbohydrates into energy. Then cells are resistant to the insulin and the glucose is not absorbed. More insulin is then produced, then glucose level rises. To bring glucose levels down, the glucose energy is stored as a fat. So in this, the main presenting features, the central obesity, the high BP, high triglyceride, low HDL, and insulin resistance. Slides are hanged. I need 2 minutes. Slides are hanged. I have to again restart.
Now what happened? That
slides are hanged. I think.
Net.
No, net too is okay, but slides are hanged. Let me see. It's hanged.
Restart.
Then I am reconnecting. I will be reconnecting, Dr. Rajeshri. I will be reconnecting. Meanwhile, you can share some of your thoughts. I will be rejoining within a minute, because it is hanged.
Okay, no problem.
Sankal, I think it has been technical glitches.
Yes. Friends, meanwhile, if any questions, please write down in the chat box.
They can ask me the questions about my topic. By that time, you can get ready. Okay?
Yes. Yeah.
So, Sankalp, ask them the any questions are there. Can you tell me?
No slides are handy.
Not moving.
Trying.
Sankalp, yes. Can you hear me? You can ask the questions to the audience if they want till Dr. Ritu finalizer. You know, sort it out. Anybody would like to ask on the COVID? All recording
has now ended. Ritu madam, sir, slide ye itne bug jara.
Ha ye 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 ek to na sir. Hang zala. Ha. I think it is visible now.
No, you have to reshare.
I have to reshare.
Ha, reshare karo.
Yes. 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 Sorry for this technical glitches. What I can do is this happens sometimes. So So meanwhile, friends, if you are having any questions, please start writing down in the chat box. Once we finish this, we can have an interactive discussion. देखो ना जैसे ही टेक्निकल ग्लिचेस आते हैं दो तीन लोग आउट हो जाते हैं बाहर सो या सो नाउ व्हाट आर द बेसिक ट्रीटमेंट फॉर दिस पीसीओएस एज वी नो फर्स्ट इज द लाइफस्टाइल मॉडिफिकेशन इज द फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट फॉर दिस पीसीओएस सो एज वी नो बाय लिमिटिंग द प्रोसेस्ड फूड्स विद एडेड शुगर्स ऑल्सो एडिंग द विद होल ग्रेन प्रोडक्ट्स फ्रूट्स वेजिटेबल्स एंड लीन मीट्स Means birth control pills have also been recommended and against this metformin and now the role of the myo-inositol is also there. Earlier when we are studying, we are giving only metformin. I don't know what has happened. Yes. Yeah. Though it is also in the history, it is recommended for the surgery ovarian drilling. But now I think very less we are doing this ovarian drilling. I want to discuss this with you, Dr. Rajeshri, later on regarding the role of the drilling. Yeah. So, as we know, in this, a weight loss of only 5% of the total body weight is associated with decreased insulin levels, improved menstrual function, reduced hirsutism and acne, and it lowers the testosterone levels. So as I told, change in the lifestyle is very, very important. So we always tell the patient to make the lifestyle active. So that is in the any form of the exercise, walking, running, Zumba, dance, or any kind of that. Especially the infertility patients also, those who are coming to us, yes, they have to make the lifestyle active. Among the change in the lifestyle, as this is smoking and alcohol is very, very prevalent in the metro cities. So they have to quit for this smoking and alcohol too. Which I think is these days is considered to be a norm. If any celebration, they are including this smoking and alcohol. So now all the studies have also come regarding the role of the vitamin D. As Dr. Rajeshri has also mentioned in this COVID era for COVID also, but now I think with everything we have a lot of studies for the relationship with this vitamin D. So the studies, so many journals, the Clinical Endocrinology, Fertility, Sterility, and JCM also supports the vitamin D deficiency is the newly identified missing link in the PCOS. So the alarming facts that 85% of the PCOS women are vitamin D deficient and associated with multiple metabolic risk factors. So now what to give? There are so many studies regarding this metformin, myo-inositol, D-carbinositol are the insulin sensitizers, which decreases the insulin resistance, decreases hyperinsulinemia, decreases hyperandrogenism, restores normal LH and FSH secretion, induces ovulation, and decreases the body mass, supported by so many journals. Now, coming to this regarding the use of the metformin. So, friends, there are a lot of pros and cons. Still, when so many young doctors joining, they all have a confusion in their mind. Ma'am, can we give metformin? And once the patient is conceived, can we continue this metformin? And when to give the myonicetol? Or can we give the combination of metformin and myonicetol? So I'm going to emphasize on that points only. So this will be a practical take home that what to give and what not to give. So friends, what the study suggests that how does metformin act? Yes, it regulates the menstrual cycle, reduces the body mass index, reduces the hyperinsulinemia. Only the main problem with this metformin is regarding of the side effects. Yes, some patients are still complaining of nausea, vomiting, headache, and gastric abdominal discomforts, and vitamin B12 deficiency associated has been reported. Yes, the studies have shown the treatment with metformin a statistically significant decrease in BMI compared with placebo, and some indication of greater effect with higher dose of metformin, more than 1500 mg per day, and longer duration of therapy, more than 8 weeks. A structured lifestyle modification program to achieve weight loss should still be the first-line treatment in obese women with or without PCOS, and there are so many RCTs studies have also been reported in the favor of this also. Yes, now up to the what duration you have to give. Yeah, the some studies have supported that at least minimum of the 8 weeks, which help in reduction in the weight, fasting glucose, triglyceride, and LDL levels, and the insulin levels, and HOMA index in the PCOS, the metformin for up to 6 months reduces the hirsutism, reduces the androgen levels with reduction in the testosterone is also reported in 25-50% of the cases. So now coming in the cases of the infertility. So yes, the metformin, randomized trials using the metformin have the improved ovulatory frequency in the females with PCOSA. Metformin in the doses of 500 mg BID or TDS restored the menstrual cyclicity in 68-95% of the patients treated for 4-6 months. Then metformin with CC increases the ovulation and pregnancy rates to the CC alone. So friends, now coming, what's the main confusion with this? Yes. Yes, even if the patient is conceived with the metformin, yes, of course, we have to continue the metformin. Not to stop abruptly the metformin. If the patient is on myonicetol or metformin, yes, we have to continue. Yes, in my clinical practice, yes, I will go through the slides, but I want to emphasize on the practical point. My clinical practice, what I have seen that some patients are totally intolerant to this metformin. Yes, but what the results you are getting from the metformin, you are not getting from this myonicetol. So as the dose is recommended from 500-1500 we are giving, in some patients I am giving 500 of this metformin and rest I am adding the myonicetol. So there are different studies have been published. There is one study for this metformin and myonicetol reduces the obesity in PCOS patients. This study by Minerva has been present that diet, metformin, and inositol in the overweight and obese women with PCOS. They have concluded from this study that body weight loss in obese PCOS patients improves the symptoms and body composition. Weight loss was dependent on adding metformin to diet. Myo was effective in restoring the regularity of menstrual cycle. Further investigation occurs to confirm metformin and myo to rule on the body composition improvement, especially regarding for how it improves the risk. So friends, before I move to other slide, I want all of you, those who are attending this, please write in the chat box that how many of you are using the metformin and how many of you are using the myonicetol and how many of you are using the combination. So please, I want answers from each and everybody. So it will be an interactive discussion, not like that I am reading the slides, some are listening and some are not listening. So friends, please write in the chat box how many of you are using the metformin and what dose and how many of you are using the myonicetol. So now coming to this inositol, yes, the myonicetols are the new insulin sensitizers. So as we know, the inositols are the C6 sugar alcohols of cyclohexane. Inositol is a component of the inositol phosphoglycans, which act as a secondary messengers in insulin signaling. Insulin resistance appears to be a main underlying metabolic. Yes, please write, friend. Write, friend. I am waiting for each and everyone reply. Please write in the chat box how many of you are using the metformin, how many of you are using this myonositol, so we can discuss later on. So, insulin resistance appears to be a main underlying metabolic derangement in PCOS, possibly due to a defect in IPG signaling. Published studies have confirmed the inositol supplementation can improve the insulin sensitivity, reduces the serum levels of insulin, testosterone, and LH, and induces the ovulation in women with PCOS. I'm able to see only 8 answers in the chat box and the audience attendance is 46. Now it's become 10. Friends, all of you, please be attentive and please reply in the chat box. How many of you are using the metformin? Now, coming to the next slide. Yeah. Now, regarding the myonositol, it is naturally occurring in one of the 9 isomers of a C6 sugar alcohol that belongs to a vitamin B complex group B7. Synthesized in the liver from glucose in our body, water soluble to each dose is well tolerated and devoid of the toxicity. So the studies have shown that in the PCOS, decrease in the inositol, decrease in the PI3 kinase, decrease in decarnosterol, which in turn increases the testosterone. Only 13 reply in the chat box from the 46, not even the half persons are writing. Then. So now it is shown the deficiency of inositol decreases the PI3 kinase activity. These slides are a little theoretical, but to explain the mechanism. Once we give this, it acts the this deficiency of inositol decreases the PI3 kinase activity, which decreases the concentration of inositol. Decrease PI3K activity. So there are a lot of studies that metformin regulates the glucose transporter translocation through AMP activated protein kinase mediated CPI-CAP signaling in T3L1 pre-adipocyte cells. So the glucose metabolism in a normal cell, insulin binds to its receptor, forms a complex insulin receptor substance. As we have just discussed, it simulates a messenger called PI3 kinase, which in turn activates GLUT4 and which is taken by GLUT4 through the glucose channel for utilizing the energy. And this myo and decarnosterol and metformin thus improves the insulin uptake and sensitivity of the insulin. So phosphatidyl inositol 3 kinase is the key messenger. We need production and activation of PI3 kinase for normal cell glucose metabolism. Inositol produces as well as activates PI3 kinase. It acts as a precursor for this, supplemented by so many of journals. Now, there is one study for this that in the PCOS, there is a deficiency of inositol. So we have seen in the PCOS subjects, the normal plasma inositol level is less compared to the normal subjects and 24 urinary inositol is more. The study has been presented in the Diabetes Care Journal. So inositol clearance levels in PCOS and normal women, the 5 times more urinary clearance of inositol in the PCOS patients. Enzyme epimerase converts the myonositol to dechiroinositol. Epimerization, the conversion is insulin dependent. So, as we know, in this, due to insulin resistance, this conversion has been stopped. So, insulin resistance, the conversion rate is affected, and the myonositol does not get converted to DCI. So the complementary action of myonositol and decarnosterol as insulin action needs the second messengers. Myonositol promotes the glucose cell intake. Decarnosterol stimulates the glycogen synthesis. I will show in one chart form also. And decarnosterol present in higher concentration in glycogen storage tissue and low in the tissue needling elevated the energy levels. So the complementary action of the myo and D-chiroinositol, it promotes the glucose cell intake, the myo, while the D-chiro stimulates the glycogen synthesis. So this is a very, very important slide. Among this myo-inositol and D-chiroinositol, it acts at ovary myo-inositol, while D-chiroinositol acts at the peripheral tissues. Myo-inositol increases the glucose cell uptake, while D-chiro stimulates the glycogen synthesis. Friends, we have to emphasize, it increases glucose cell intake and it stimulates the glycogen synthesis. Myo-inositol normalizes the LH-FSH ratio, while D-chiroinositol reduces the insulin resistance, increases the insulin sensitivity. Yes, myo-inositol is very good. It increases the oocytes quality, while D-chiroinositol reduces the hyperinsulinemia. Myo-inositol reduces the amount of the FSH, whether the urinary or recombinant, it reduces the amount of the FSH during the IVF cycle. While with D-chiro, there is no effect at the ovarian level, no direct effect on the fertility. Yes, the myo with the results have been reported an improvement in the IVF results and reduces the risk of the metabolic syndrome. Yeah. So what are the advantages of adding of this? Yes, the myo-inositol and D-chiroinositol research indicates that a combination of myo and D-chiroinositol in the body physiological ratio of 40:1 is more beneficial than either alone. The combination improved the metabolic parameters more than myo-inositol alone. After 3 months of the treatment in overweight female with PCOS, this combination improved the lipid profile in obese women with PCOS. The combination of this improves the egg and the embryo quality and the pregnancy rates in the female with PCOS. So there are a lot of studies have been reported by this Kolachinigari that it not only improves the embryo and egg quality, but it also increases the pregnancy rates. Yeah. So now there are a lot of clinical evidences regarding the support of this also. They have all shown the combined treatment of this reduces the risk of the metabolic disease in the PCOS. Yeah. The studies have shown the with this combination using the improvement in the total testosterone and sex hormone binding globulin is seen in the 3 and 6 months. There are different parameters they have taken: total testosterone, free testosterone, DHEA, SHBG, and androstenedione. So thus, the lot of studies that the combined treatment is the physiological ratio of 40:1 is able to restore the both the hormonal and metabolic parameters in overweight PCOS women earlier than in myo-inositol alone. So there are a lot of, again, study has been presented by Minozzi and Nordio, where the combined therapy and the physiological ratio reduces the risk of the CVS disease by improving the lipid profile in PCOS patients. So they have done a study on the 20 overweight patients, and they have shown that how it is beneficial on the all the parameters. Yeah. The combined therapy has been shown the significant improvement in lipid profile, in the basal metabolic rate, in the waist to hip ratio, BP, and HOMA index. After 12 weeks of myo-inositol administration, the insulin sensitivity and HOMA index is significantly improved. We have seen the 56% reduction. The hemostatic model assessment method is used to quantify the insulin resistance and beta cell function. It was first described under the name of by HOMA by the Matrix et al. At 1985. So studies have shown that myo-inositol decreases both insulin and BMI. No changes were seen in the patients who were treated with folic acid. So there are a lot of studies have come now to add the adjuvants also in the treatment. So there's so many studies have been presented for this use and myo-inositol along with the folic acid, because every day in our OPD, we are seeing one or the other companies coming, some of the different combinations. Some is coming with myo-inositol with chromium, myo-inositol with zinc, myo-inositol with vitamin D. So now what to give, what not to give. So yes, but there are a lot of studies now is there that Myonestrol is a simple and safe treatment and should be primarily method for inducing the ovulation in the PCOS woman. There are a lot of studies in the favor of this. That how it causes the reduction in the metabolic parameters. You can see in the systolic BP, diastolic BP, triglyceride and total cholesterol. So the Myonestrol take care of the symptoms. It improves the insulin sensitivity, decreases the insulin resistance, improves the glucose tolerance, improves pregnancy rate, restores the menstruation and reduces the free level of the testosterone. So there are a lot of studies that up to when to give, up to 2 months, 3 months or up to 1 year. So there are different studies have been presented. So all have concluded that it is a simple and safe treatment capable of restoring and spontaneous ovarian activity. Nothing like that, that this therapy did not cause any multiple pregnancy. So why we are using, we IVF specialists are using the Myonestrol for improving the egg quality too. The Myonestrol provides a good quality oocytes. There are a lot of studies. It provides the good quality oocytes will help in increasing the follicular maturity. This has been seen the increase in acetol in the follicular fluids. It plays a key role in the nucleus and cytoplasmic oocyte development. Higher concentration of Myonestrol in a follicular fluid is marked as a good quality of oocytes. The studies had been supported by so many journals. The International Society suggests that, just a second, I'll take this one. Yeah. Regarding the use of this Myonestrol and metformin, now adding of this adjuvant, this folic acid and vitamin B12, there are a lot of preparations are coming which help additional folic acid and B12 also in them. It also helps in decreases the risk of the cancer, depression, dementia, heart disease. And maintain the energy level. And methylcobalamin is a cofactor for the methionine synthetase, which reduces the toxic homocysteine to the essential amino acids methionine. 2-3 slides more. I know I have exceeded the time. Yes. So this metformin in the PCOS causes and solution, yes, genetics, lifestyle, environment, which all increases the insulin and increased androgens. And while giving this metformin, Myonestrol, B12, and changing in this lifestyle pattern, changing in the diet, and addition of this micronutrients will also help in the treatment. So there are a lot of studies in the favor of this. So thank you to all of the listeners for the patient hearing. Because PCOS is such a vast topic, we can't. So for this adolescent PCOS in the infertility age group, so there are a lot and lot of to discuss on the PCOS. So how much I can take in this half an hour, I try to include in this lecture. So thank you. Thank you once again for patient hearing. I forgot the name because many thanks to Lalit ji and Amit ji also. They all are also very, very helpful once I have been attached with this InnovaCare. I was thinking of that only in that presentation. So yes, thank you. Thank you to all of you. Let me see in the chat box if anything. Yes. Dr. Noha, you are from where? Never use Inositol as not have. No, Inositols are available now worldwide. You are from which country, Dr. Noha? Yeah, Dr. Kariman, thank you so much. Oman, in Oman it is available, Dr. Noha. It is available in the Oman. You please WhatsApp me your number. I will add you in the group. We are having so many doctors from Oman. Oh, in the Oman it is available. WhatsApp me on my number. You please connect me. Yes, Dr. Meenu is saying, yeah, hi, Patana, how are you? Patana is very, very dear friend, a very, very famous gynecologist of the Afghanistan. Thank you for joining. Dr. Rajeshri, I'm just checking the comments and questions. Then we can discuss. Okay.
Rajeshri ma'am, please unmute.
Yes, I unmuted it. Kariman, I think she has done, they have done a lot of case series about this COVID also. In her experience, she would like to save us. So I think she can send me on the WhatsApp or any personal, my email also.
He, not she.
I have not seen them. Can you start with the gallery view so that at least we can see them?
Dr. Kariman, you can unmute. Yes, Dr. Noha, it's correct. You are writing that you are starting with 500 BID. Yes, we are also giving either 1000 mg or we are giving sometimes 1500 also. The sustained release tablet is available. We are giving like that. Yeah, hi Pallavi. Pallavi has also joined. Pallavi Gupta, yeah, thank you for joining. Yes, correct. We are using both this. Yes. Hi Preeti. Preeti is also correct. Shivani is also correct. Yes, everyone is having their own. Yes, Dr. Kariman is saying that he is using. Yeah, Dr. Geeta is saying metformin. Yes, Dr. Meena is writing. Achha, she is using. Achha, Mayo in the obese and lean and thin minocetol. Okay. Yes, Monica, Dr. Monica is saying she is using in the combination. Yes. Yes, Rupali, Dr. Rupali Jain is saying that she is using metformin. Dr. Veena Vidyasagar, madam, is saying metformin, blood sugar levels, and patient is not able to reduce weight. Okay. Dr. Renu Bhatia is saying used in a combination. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Renu Bhatia.
Okay, I think somebody has asked me the question about the route of the delivery in a COVID.
Yes.
So I say, COVID itself is not an indication for any cesarean section unless it is an indicated for the fetal or the maternal the thing, you know. Suppose there is a fetal distress, there is a contracted pelvis, go for the cesarean section. COVID itself is not an indication for the this thing. So I will prefer to go for the vaginal delivery if everything is fine with the mother and the baby. And second thing is that I would like to go more with the spinal anesthesia or the epidural one. The regionals are the better, but don't go for the general anesthesia because it is aerosol, this thing, you know, generating procedures. So that care has to be taken, because in one of in our experience, there was one thing is that suddenly somebody has intubated because there was a fetal distress and all, and then that aerosol gets generated and you can become a positive. So now in wherever you are there in a either gynecology, elective surgeries, emergency surgery, first important thing is to you have to protect yourself. And that is very, very important.
True. Agreed. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Rajeshri. Yeah. Yes. Hi, Nishant. Nishant is a very popular in my all academic groups. Yeah. Thank you, Nishant, for joining. Yeah. Nishant is writing, I prefer minocetol and it does not have any notorious effects like metformin. Okay. Agreed. Yes. Pallavi has asked the question, ma'am, can we use both inositol and metformin together? Yes, we can use. If you have listened my full presentation, in most of my patients, I am giving the combination. I am giving minositol too and giving metformin too. Yes, we can use. Can we unmute Dr. Kariman Webber? He has raised the hands. He wants to share some views with Dr. Rajeshri's permission.
Unmuted.
Yeah, sure. I'll be happy.
Yeah, Dr. Kariman, we want to listen, hear you.
Yes.
You can make a video also if we can.
Good evening. Hamza?
Hi.
How are you?
Hi. Yeah, we are fine.
For Dr. Rashi, for for delivery, you prefer C-section or normal delivery?
I go for a normal delivery because that is the one thing where you will have a less risk in that. But if it is indicated for the fetal region, then go for cesarean section. But I'll prefer for the vaginal delivery route.
Okay, okay, thanks.
What you are doing? What you are doing, Dr. Kariman? What you are doing in your country? What you are doing? Normal delivery or cesarean section?
We prefer C-section. We have more C-section.
Okay, okay. For this COVID, okay. For this COVID patients.
Yes.
Okay, okay.
Immediately emergency. We have more case.
Okay.
And we go to C-section.
Kariman, okay. We are getting the patient with the either asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. So our patients, they get delivered very nicely and without any complication also. There might be, you might be having in a severe group of the things and you wanted to deliver it at the expedited time.
We that have multiple patients with multiple symptoms. Okay. We have mild symptoms.
I agree with you.
Depends, Yanni.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Okay, okay.
Yes.
For Dr. Ritu.
Yes, yes, Dr. Kariman. Hi, yeah.
We have more, PCO is universal. This problem is universal.
Yes, yes.
Some obstetrician here in Lebanon use contraception. Like okay. Diane.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, yeah. We also use, today my talk is focused on this metformin and minocetol. That's why I have not included that. Yes, we are also using in some patients, but the patients, as I'm an infertility specialist, so most of the patients are coming for the infertility treatment. So, yeah. So, yes, so I'm starting this combination, metformin and minocetol. So, getting a very, very good results.
I have good results, but I ask now.
Yeah.
If we have relation between progesterone during pregnancy for the mother,
uh-huh.
And the girl baby, she developed after polycystic ovary?
There are
after
some
delivery in her life?
See,
is there have relation between progesterone and this?
Yeah, there are some studies. I am also going through these papers. Yesterday only find some papers, but not enough studies. Some papers are saying that if the progesterone is giving the chances of PCOS are increasing. There are some papers, not many papers. Some papers are only there.
I prepare paper for this now with my patient.
I prepare
a publication for this.
Okay.
I need 2 months.
Acha, okay. You are presenting means for this. The progesterone is doing the PCOS in the patients. Okay.
Yes. The relation between progesterone what during is, pregnancy see? And polycystic ovary in the future of girl.
Okay.
Kariman, I can say that they are saying that in a PCOS cases, if you give the progesterone, again, there are some papers that causes the stabilization of the pregnancy also. So yes. Some of the world literature is also saying that stabilizing the pregnancy and continue the pregnancy with the progesterone in cases of the PCOS. That is also papers has been published and in our experience also with the progesterone, yes. The patient, you know, they can go continue the pregnancy uneventfully.
Okay.
We give
because I have more patients. Her girl developed polycystic ovary, and during pregnancy, the mother take. Progesterone.
Okay, you mean in the future.
Yeah. Yes. But okay. some studies are there, but still. There.
But they don't have a long time follow, you know, long term follow is not much there in that.
True.
So let's okay. Also, okay. If you come with a good paper, we will all read.
okay.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Kariman, for joining.
Okay. Thank you so for you.
Okay. Yeah.
For sharing the experiences.
Yeah. Dr. Faiza is writing, it needs many years to confirm this study. Yes, agreed, Dr. Faiza. Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. Dr.
Because, very short data is available. So what the consequences of the PCOS, because PCOS is a very hot topic nowadays. True. So people, they have studied in a perimenopausal adolescence and everything with the CA endometrium. Now they are studying what will be the effect on the offsprings. So all these things, I think they are coming in True. The pipeline.
True. There's one question from the Dr. Pallavi. She is writing, is it necessary to do ovulation induction when we are using minocytol in PCOS patients? Yes, you can go ahead. No problem.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can do now.
Uh-huh. Yeah. But you have to keep the monitoring aapko acche se karna, because the patients, PCOS patients, anytime can go to OHSS. So, yeah. So in these patients, if the patient is PCOS, it goes to the OHSS. So, yes, the metformin is a very good study, because on Monday only I presented a paper, the role of metformin in the treatment of in the OHSS. So there are a lot of studies. If in the PCOS patients, if you are stimulating with CC or letrozole, preferences these days is letrozole. So of course, if the patient is on the metformin, please continue that. So the chances of going to the OHSS will be less. Dr. Faiza, you can unmute yourself. Yeah. Yeah, Dr. Faiza, you can unmute yourself and share your thoughts. Dr. Faiza is writing a strong relationship between the environments and nutrition. Yes, correct. If you want, you can unmute. Vaibhav, can we unmute Dr. Faiza? Yes. Yeah, hi, Dr. Faiza.
Hello, how are you?
Yeah, fine. Dr. Faiza, please introduce yourself to others. I know you very well. Introduce yourself, that you are from where. I know you very well, but for rest, everyone else also know.
Thank you so much. I'm a Libyan obstetric and gynecologist.
Yeah.
A very warm welcome. Arab country.
Libya, yes, warm Arab welcome. Country. Warm welcome, Dr. Faiza. Thank you for joining.
Thanks a lot. Thanks. I'm using metformin since long time.
Okay.
And it has a very interesting results.
Yeah.
Yes, it is good metformin. Because
with nutritional change and environmental, some environment and some, a lot of things, yeah.
Yes, agreed. Because here also we are getting so many combinations. Now the combinations are coming. This metformin or minocytol with the chromium is separately coming, because chromium again will help in the insulin resistance. Some companies have come with the zinc is also coming now due to this corona. I want to know everybody's opinion for this ovulation induction. Dr. Faiza, Dr. Kariman, I want your opinion also. And of course, Dr. Rajeshree, our esteemed faculty. Huh? So we are using this CC or letrozole. How many of you are using the melatonin also? Melatonin is a very, we are getting so a lot of studies for this melatonin. Are you using in your country, Dr. Faiza, Dr. Kariman? Let me know your opinion too.
No, I'm not using the melatonin.
Okay.
I use, but not more. Yani, it's very important. In Italy, the obstetrician use melatonin before sleep. 3 milligrams before sleep.
Yes.
For 14 days, tariban. Okay. We start to use melatonin. We start. And I sent for you the study for this. Okay. Melatonin use for polycystic ovary.
Yes. Any more questions? Anyone want to discuss any more questions?
I'm using some nutritional supplement like vitamin D. I introduce vitamin D in all of my polycystic case.
Yes.
It has a very good result.
What rightly said Faiza also, Kariman and Dr. Ritu also. So basically in PCOS also, apart from the drugs, the change in the lifestyle is very, very important in that. There is a definitive role of these micronutrients and the exercises. which is very important, because what it happens, the more the obesity, adipose tissue, and this resistance of the insulin is one of the cause where this metformin is being used, and that's why we are getting a very good results in that. And I agree with Kariman that about what she said about the melatonin, though I have not used it, but there are promising results with that. What they say is, if you give it, it really helps in regularization of the hormones also, and quite relaxing in that. So I think one should try for that also.
Combination inositol with melatonin, doctor, together. Melatonin and inositol. Yes. We have studied.
Yes.
Here we are getting the combination of this clomiphene and clomiphene with melatonin. I am using in some patients, and I am to getting most of these Google Savvy patients. They on the counter itself study this melatonin.
So you should give a separate melatonin to them before they come to you.
true.
We use chemotherapy melatonin.
Yes. That's how it has been come out of it, no? For the regularization of the system.
Yeah, Dr. Beena Nayak, madam, thank you for joining. Beena madam is always joined my all webinars. Thank you for joining.
Thank you, madam.
Beena ma'am, please unmute yourself. Beena ma'am, want to give some opinion regarding the use in the menopause. Beena ma'am, you can unmute yourself. Vaibhav, please help. Otherwise, make me host so I can do unmute. Mere paas idhar se WhatsApp pe bhi message aa raha hai bar-bar jisko
jisko. Yes, you are already host. Co-host, you can unmute.
Okay.
You shared the slides, that means you are co-host. They must have made it,
अभी वापस बंद कर दिया होगा ना?
Time ज़्यादा हो
गया. I think there are no more questions. Yes.
So I think let me thank first to them, then you can wind it up. I think thanks Uncle Vaibhav, Amit, and the whole team for that. Thanks all the organizers, and thanks all the participants, Dr. Ritu, then Dr. Kariman, Ghazal, Faizia, then Dr. Beena, and everyone, those who have listened it very patiently, and it's a very good knowledge sharing platform, highlighting both the topics, though COVID is need of the time to look in the matter of the COVID pregnancy or COVID delivery. But at the same time, what we can say, just now I delivered one lecture in a ICOG national conference. In that, my talk was that this reduction of the maternal mortality in a non-communicable diseases. There, my first line was that though we are in a COVID pandemic, but still you have to face the pandemic of non-communicable diseases. In that, all these diseases, they do come in that, like, you know, diabetes, hypertension, and all these things.
So, I agree.
It's a long way to go, and very nicely presented Dr. Ritu, and all must have been happy to listen the
those kiski who so
they told me to talk on the another topic. I said no, very important, because we are working and we are first hand experiences for that. So I chosen this upbeat topic for the gynec webinars.
Great.
Thank you.
Yeah. Dr. Nishant is giving the comment that melatonin helps in improving the production of progesterone from corpus luteum. Yes, totally agree.
Yes,
Nishant, please unmute yourself. Unmute yourself. And and speak some words. Because Sankalp will enlighten us, because this company is also having a very good combination of this drug. So Sankalp will tell little bit about the drug. Meanwhile, we Sankalp, first you carry on, then we will have some words with from the Nishant. Nishant, are you there? Nishant, please unmute yourself.
Nishant? Yes, thank you, Ritu madam. Yeah, as madam has rightly told that we have one brand which is used for PCOS. Now we have one more brand, like we have two brands which are used in PCOS. One is for obese PCOS, where BMI more than 25, and another is for lean PCOS, when BMI is less than 25. Metinopol, which is a brand of metformin, per myoresmol and decarbazitol, along with vitamin B12. This is a one brand, metinopol. Additionally, we are offering folic acid also. Another brand we have, if you have another choice, we have N-acetylcysteine instead of metformin. Doctors may not prescribe in adolescent age group metformin. For them, we have another option, N-acetylcysteine, which has a similar efficacy and similar effects like metformin in insulin sensitization. So we have another brand, Nactinophol. So basically, as the doctor has rightly mentioned, that the one brand which can be prescribed at all the age groups is Metinophol, which is a metformin 500 milligram and MIDC and a physiological ratio of 40:1, along with vitamin B12, which can be given additionally due to there will be a deficiency of B12 because of the use of metformin. So additionally, we are providing vitamin B12 into it. So this is the two brands which we have, Metinophol and Nactinophol. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Sankalp. We will have some words with Nishant. Nishant, please unmute yourself. Nishant, are you there? You unmute yourself, then we will wind off. Yes, yeah. Hi, Nishant.
Yeah, hi, ma'am. Yeah, good evening, everyone. Good evening, Rajeshwari, ma'am, and good evening.
Yeah, good evening, Nishant. Good to see you.
Yeah, ma'am, thank you. Ma'am, actually, what I have seen, the deficiency of melatonin also alter the gonadotropin secretion.
Yes.
And also as well secretion. But the thing is, melatonin combination is a little expensive to give, and where I practice, this is not fully corporate section, so it is quite difficult for us to write melatonin combination drug. And the thing is, whenever we write prescribe metformin, there are many studies says that metformin decreases the B12 level. But last year I have done a study on that. I have separated this male and female. This thing data I have collected from the physician. There is no as such like clinically effect on the B12 level.
Okay.
Whenever we advise patient for the metformin and
Okay. So Nishant, can you share these some studies in the academic group? Nishant?
Yeah, ma'am.
These are all doctors in the academic group. You're saying. Yes, Dr. Preeti, you can unmute yourself. Dr. Preeti has raised her hand. At present, at this time, 6 webinars are going on, Dr. Rajeshri, you know, of the FOXY.
Yes. But still, it's good.
Yes, Dr. Preeti, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Preeti Badade. Yeah, I think her...
So I think if she is not having any question, we will
have connection issues must be there. Because her voice is not going in there.
Okay.
I think it's
so Sankalp, we can wind off as there are no questions, so we can wind off.
Yes. Yes, Sankalp.
Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Rajeshri madam and Dr. Ritu madam. Thank you so much. It was interactive, informative session we had. Thank you so much and see you soon again after 15 days.
Yes.
Thank you, Ritu madam.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Good night to everyone.